All right, so have you ever come up to a situation and where you knew something needed to be done, but you felt like it was just too big or too overwhelming and you weren't sure that you had anything really to offer in the moment, and like, I don't really have anything useful to add, maybe I could do something, but what happens is the moment seems so huge or so big that your contribution might seem so small that you ended up not doing anything at all. You ever had that? I think most of us have felt that way before in some situation. And so this lesson from Mark 14, if you felt that way, I hope that it will encourage you to step into whatever moment that comes to you, even if you don't feel like anything that you have to offer is significant. The truth is that we do have something to do. And our contribution, what we'll learn from the lesson today, from this chapter, is that it might be far more significant than we can ever imagine. So when I was reading and studying chapter 14 and getting ready for this lesson, my initial plan was just to brush over this section, this first 11 verses here, not because it's not important, but because we have such limited time in this kind of teaching format. And so after I got finished writing all 25 lessons and I was done with the whole thing, I kept coming back to this passage right here. And I was like, I think there's something more here, and I think we need to go over this, which is why we're doing what we're doing tonight, is because I think it's really, really important and it deserves some more exploration. And this passage of scripture, I hope, will jar us out of that numbness that keeps us from stepping into those moments and realize that we're not helpless, and that there is something always that we can do and that God calls us to do. And so let's just jump in and start with verse 1. And so we have, remembering where we are, orienting us. Mark has always given us these orientation kind of phrases that tells us where we are in the story. And then verse 1 says, now the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were only 2 days away. Now, this is the last week of Christ's life. We've been here for a while. And we are very close to the crucifixion. The plot against Jesus is in full swing. That's why it says here the chief priests and teachers of the law were looking for some sly way to arrest Jesus and kill him, but they didn't want to do it during the feast because they thought people might riot. But so, ironically, here they're plotting against Jesus and finding this time, looking for a place when they could come against him. But ironically, while everyone is getting ready to slaughter their Passover lambs, they are plotting against the ultimate Passover lamb and celebrating this feast that pointed to the ultimate redemptive work that he was going to do for them. So it's crazy, right, how these people who knew the law and studied the law could be so clueless and miss the biggest work of God ever in all of history. Now, no, the situations are different now. The truth is we're all capable of that. And we can miss obvious things or get locked into a way of thinking because of our traditions, because of our backgrounds, because of our family upbringings. And it can lead us in the wrong direction. We're so convinced of our rightness, just like they thought they were, that we end up very far away from what God is trying to lead, what God is trying to lead us. And that's why we always have to read the Word of God with a submissive and sensitive heart. That is, God, you know what? When I read this, I could be wrong. I could be wrong about this. And say to Him, show me the truth here that I might not miss you. And so keep that in your mind whenever you read the Scriptures and study the Word. Always, God, I want to know you. I want to know the truth more than I want to be right. Okay, so verse 3 goes on and tells us that while he was in Bethany, remember he's back there, and he was reclining at the table in the home of a man named Simon the leper. And so there's a dinner party going on here. Simon the leper, it's safe to say, Luke chapter 10, we know this is the passage here where we often get the question for women, are you a Mary or a Martha, right? So Martha is the one that's distracted by doing all the serving, and she's upset because Mary is where? Sitting at the feet of Jesus, listening to what he has to say. So Mary is first introduced to us as one who is focused from the start on the words and the teachings of Jesus. Everything else is secondary to her. Next time we see her is at the tomb of Lazarus, her brother. And that passage is too long to go through here in this time. But you know the story. Lazarus is dead 4 days. Jesus shows up, interacts with both Mary and Martha. And in fact, this anointing that we're looking at here in Mark chapter 14 only takes place a few weeks after the raising of Lazarus. You know, probably a month, maybe 6 weeks, probably no more than that. And so, but remember, before Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, he gathers at the tomb, weeps with them, feels their pain, and then, you know that stunning resurrection where he calls Jesus, calls Lazarus out of the tomb. Now, that's going to leave an impression on you, right? You're not going to forget that. And it makes a huge impact on Mary. And it solidified, I am sure, in her mind that he is the Christ. He is the Messiah. I don't think there's anything you could have said to her to convince her otherwise, which leads us and leads her to this moment in chapter 14. So you can't really understand what's going on here and why she does what she does without understanding the established relationship that Mary already has with Jesus. It's the motivation behind everything. This act of worship flows out of her existing relationship with him. Before she does anything for Jesus, she has taken the time to get to know Jesus, okay? And that's really important. See, for us, we can come up with all kinds of strategies of what to do and how to do and when to do and where to do and all those kind of things in our own strength, right? And in our own intellect. But it can be way off unless we first start just like Mary did, and that's at the feet of Jesus. We have to know who he is and receive from him before we can ever get the service part and the worship part right. So, let's keep going. Mary anoints Jesus, and here's the response. Mark gives us the response of the people in the room. Some of those presents were saying indignantly to one another, why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages and the money given to the poor. And they rebuked her harshly. So everyone around her is criticizing her. And the English translation, indignantly, doesn't really quite give us the flavor of what's going on here. So the Greek word here really means scolding, literally snorting with anger. And it's used to talk about horses or animals. And if we think more modernly for us, maybe a matador in a bullfight. And you know how he taunts the bull, and the more angry he gets, his nostrils flare and his eyes narrow and he stomps his feet and all that. That's kind of what this word here means. And so the people in the room with her, remember now, including the disciples, okay, respond to Mary with this flaring nostrils and this visible agitation and anger at what she's done here. And from John, the Gospel of John, we know that it was led by Judas, but others join in. He's not by himself. And notice that they deem it a waste. But that gives us insight into what the people in the room were thinking about Jesus himself. Because if they know that Jesus is the Messiah and really believe that Christ, the Son of the living God, as Peter has said not too long ago, then is any amount of money a waste for him? The best perfumes should be poured on the King of Kings, right? No doubt Mary probably thought, this is not good enough for him. It's all that I have. You see, they harshly criticize Mary and her action here, but at the same time, they're demeaning Jesus. They're saying, in fact, saying, you know, he's really not worth it. He's really not worth that perfume there. You could have done something better with that gift. You could have sold it and given it away. It's a big contrast in understanding. between what Mary was doing and what the people in the room were doing. But Jesus steps in and he defends her. And he says, leave her alone. Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. And so really, in this culture, women weren't supposed to be out in the main party area. They were expecting Mary to be back with Martha serving and making food. And certainly not out here doing something such that would cause such attention and bring out focus on her and on Jesus. But Jesus defends her, and his response is as strong as their rejection. It is an authoritative command here, leave her alone, and it demanded that they comply. And so he straightens out their perspective, and they say it's a waste. He says it's beautiful, and then he gives a twofold reason for his commendation of her. And the first that he points out is there's a limited opportunity. That's what's in verse 7. The poor you will always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want, but you will not always have me. So their objection here was that she could have sold the perfume and given it to take care of the poor. Now that was a good thing for them to want to do. The poor was really important to the Jews in this culture because that was kind of the mark of a pious Jew that you gave away and cared for the poor. And so here it's using this objection to her, but at the same time trying to highlight their own virtue. It's kind of like, hey, look, Jesus, make her stop. She's wasting something valuable that could be used better to take care of the poor, implication, like we would. And so, I mean, I'd be like, taking care of the poor people was what we would have done had we had that money. That's what we'd have done. We'd have sold it, we'd take care of the poor. Now, probably not, but that's what that is kind of implying here. So Jesus deflects that objection by reminding them that poor people are always with you and will be around until Jesus comes back again. And so he's kind of pushing back against them a little bit here. And so he's not indifferent to the suffering of the poor people. In fact, what he's saying here to them is, you're so worried about the poor, then you guys can help them anytime. Tomorrow, next week, next month, next year, like maybe even now. Start helping them now. But he's saying she only has a limited opportunity to perform this magnificent act of worship. And remember now, he's told them already on three different occasions in the Gospels, clearly what's going to happen to him. He said this over and over and over again to them. This is not veiled teaching. He's not hidden anymore. He's saying, look, the plot against me is going to be successful. They are going to kill me. I am going to die. Now, of course, he says he's going to rise again, but he's reminding them of what's happened. He's preparing them, and we have to assume that Mary's probably heard this for herself too, and she believed. I mean, if she doesn't understand at some point, some level, why do this? So, but she believes and then acts on this knowledge, so limited opportunity. Then Jesus highlights for her, or for us, the significance of the anointing. That's verse 8. She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare me for my burial. So a little bit of history about this. The perfume that she brought was from the spikenard plant from India. Very expensive, as it says back earlier in the passage. And it's the very best oil that there is out there. Highly valued, very aromatic. And it says in the Gospel of John that when she pours this out, the scent fills the entire household. And it was sticky and thick. And it would cling to hair and to skin. Back in verse 3, we see that she pours it on his head. And so John's gospel tells us that it was about a pint. And that's about 13 ounces in today's measurements. Think a can of soda, so that's 12 ounces. So it's, think a Coke can, not just a few drops that she pours out. This is a whole can of Coke, that much. Now, the container of this perfume was an alabaster jar with a very long neck. know, shaped like a teardrop, usually a work of art in itself. It had carvings on it a lot of times, and it had a sealed stopper in the top, so that would keep the perfume contained and also keep it pure. And the only way to access it was to break the neck off of it, and then you could pour it all out. So that's what she does, and pours the whole 13 ounces off onto his head. And you can imagine this runs down into his hair, onto his clothes, down over his body, and she also pours it on his feet. And so this is such a strong perfume that it would have lingered. Now, especially back then, the hygiene was different back then. People didn't change clothes every day. In fact, you might have one outfit or two outfits at the most. They didn't shower and take baths like we do in our culture today, every day. So let's think a little bit more about this. Let's think about how this might have gone. Now imagine the scene. Whole bottle of perfume has been poured on Jesus. Now this is not just gonna disappear, right? Sticky stuff in the hair, on the clothes. And if you think about going by a perfume counter at the store or past Bath and Body Works, how strong that is, right? I mean, you can, or think about somebody who wears too much perfume at your work. I mean, you can smell it when they come in, after they go, it's still lingering. And so this is like that, strong lingers in the air, doesn't fade away. Now remember where we are in the story. This is only mere days, even hours away from the crucifixion and all the events that lead up to that. So let's think how this perfume might have lingered on his body. No showers, remember again, not going home to change clothes and toss it in the wash. So he's wearing this. It clung to him. Next thing that happens here is the Last Supper. Imagine he comes into this room with the smell on his clothes. John, who reclined with his head on Jesus' shoulder, certainly could smell it, if not every one of the disciples in the room. Next thing after that is Gethsemane. And what we learn to know about that, he's sweating drops of blood when he's wrestling with the Father. Imagine that this perfume is mixed with the sweat, and as he sweats, this comes out of his body. And then after that, he goes to Pilate. Could Pilate smell the perfume when they brought him in to stand trial? When the soldiers scourged his body with every whip and every lash, did they also smell this perfume filling the air of this room? Or this, where they're carrying out this against him. The soldiers who bent over to drive the nails in his hands could certainly have smelled it in his hair. Could they have smelled that sweetness? Maybe the soldier who won the clothing took it home and it filled the air of his room, of his household. Could Jesus have smelled this perfume in his hair when he bowed his head? Gave up his spirit. What she did in this devoted act here, this act of love and act of worship, could have been the sweet aroma that was with him until he burst forth in his glorious resurrection. Does that change the story for you? It did for me. Can you see the significance of what happened in this moment in a new and kind of lasting way? How beautiful might this have been to Christ in his deepest, most devastating, most distressing moment to have the fragrance of devoted love and worship still swirling about him. Now, she certainly didn't know everything that was coming, but maybe she had a deeper understanding and a faith to believe than the others. Maybe God had given her an insight into the horrific truth that was coming and about to unfold, and instead of resisting and fighting and denying and refusing, maybe she simply believed. And because of that belief, it motivated her to do something that blessed and encouraged Jesus in his deepest moments of sorrow. Simple faith that motivated her to go and do, to follow through, even when everybody told her stop. Look at verse 9. It says, I tell you the truth, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her. Now, Jesus pairs this act of devotion, this extravagant gift that she gave, with the telling of the gospel. Now, the most obvious way to look at how that was fulfilled is that this story is actually written in all four of the gospels. This incident is included in all of the accounts. So when we read the gospels, that's a way that it can be paired with the gospel. And I kept thinking about this idea here. It kind of grabbed me, and I began to ponder what this incident might have been, being paired with the gospel, what that might have been meant. I mean, if you're explaining the gospel to somebody, you usually don't include this story, right? Okay, Jesus died for your sins, and Mary poured perfume on Jesus. I mean, you just don't usually include that, right? Not really what happens. Roman road to salvation, you don't veer off into Bethany, you include this story, right? We don't. So, but I kept thinking about this and thinking about this, and it wouldn't let me go. And so it was like, but I thought that maybe like so much of what Jesus says, that maybe there's more than the obvious meaning of that it's just written down for us to read. So, like I said, I thought about it a fair amount, and this is where I landed, okay? This is just me. I didn't read this anywhere, so if you don't agree, it's okay. But when this story is coupled with the telling of the gospel, could he have meant something else besides the obvious? Could it be that what she did is a picture of the gospel? Without knowing it, that she presented a living metaphor of what was about to happen in the cross, on the cross in just a few hours. Look at it. What'd she do? She gave just the right time. He said, you got a limited opportunity. She gave completely. She poured out everything. She gave extravagantly and exactly what was needed at this time. Is that not the gospel? Okay? Isn't that Christ, what Christ does for us in only a few hours later? Christ's act of devotion. At just the right time, Galatians 4, 5, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent his son, born of a woman, under the law, so that he might redeem those under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons and daughters. It's completely poured out. Titus 3, 5 and 6, he saved us, not on the basis of deeds, but according to his mercy, the washing of regeneration and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out upon us richly through Christ Jesus, our Savior. Extravagantly, Ephesians 1, 7 and 8. In him we have redemption through his blood for the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished on us. That's not stingy and miserly. That's extravagantly poured out on us. And then finally, exactly what was needed. Galatians again. The Lord Christ, who gave himself for our sins so that he might rescue us from this present evil age. So I hope you look at this story differently now. I hope that will make a different impact on you, not just somebody pouring perfume out, but this is just a flat story if we don't do anything with it, right? So all the way back to where we started, and that's with the feeling that sometimes we don't have enough to bring to a situation. The takeaway for us right here, right now, in this moment, is in the beginning of verse 8. She did what she could. She did what she could. This phrase is only in the Gospel of Mark. It's so powerful. You know, we all can't stand on stages in front of thousands of people or start organizations that reach around the world or head up charities or outreaches. We all can't go on full-time missions, but you can do something, right? You can always do something. There's something you can invest in. Talk to one or two people about Jesus. Help in preschool. Pray for people that you interact with on your job. Love the people who are in your life, even when they're not lovable, right? There's something. There's nobody who can't do something. Here's the thing. The advancement of the kingdom of God isn't dependent solely on you. It's important what you do. Even crucial, but it's always paired with the other people from the body of Christ. We look at this scene again. Mary did what she could, and it was bigger than she could have imagined, right? That's the big takeaway from here. First thing to remember that you can do something, and sometimes what you do is much larger than you can imagine or to D.L. Moody, or to your grandmother, or your teacher, or somebody that you led you to the Lord. Really big impact, right? But Mary's contribution wasn't the only one in this scene. Remember, Martha served. She was in the background. She was doing what she could do as well. And so did Simon the leper. I mean, the party is at his house, right? And you can even say maybe Lazarus did what he could too. This is after his glorious resurrection there. The crowds show up to see him, talk to him. He could have said, oh, I can't handle that. I mean, but he is the poster boy for the power of God right now. So he speaks up, he talks, he interacts. So don't be overwhelmed at the enormity of a situation or the problems around you. Just be convinced of who Jesus is. And let that become the central motivator for you to act and do something. Then you know what? If you do it, and you do it, and you do it, and you do it, and you do it, then it all gets done. So if you're looking at your life and you're going, well, not anything I can do to specifically serve Jesus, and take this verse to heart. She did what she could. And then find something to invest in. Size is not important. Flashiness is not important. Devotion and sincerity is what matters. Get busy. Go out. Do something in the power of the Holy Spirit. Remember, it's not up to you to do it. He provides the power for us to do what he calls us to do. Remember from chapter 13 last week? Time is short. Don't let the master return and find you sleeping. Amen? God, we just thank you for this wonderful story of Mary and her devotion and how important it was, even beyond what we can see sometimes on the surface. God, help it motivate us to step up and do, even when it feels overwhelming or like people want us to be quiet. God, let us be so convinced of who you are that nothing is too much to give. And we pray this in the power of your Son's name.